We're gonna do the twist and it goes like this.
My name is Eric Oakday and I'm a mural painter who created a project based around South Philadelphia singers called South Philadelphia Musicians Remix.
Philadelphia has a pretty robust mural arts program, and I've been lucky enough to be a part of it for 20 years. I get these commissions to do these murals, and this one came around. It was one of those things where it was the right place, right time. The mural is located at Broadtasker, and it's about the bandstand era of musicians in Philadelphia. It highlights some of the places and things of the time, like some of the clubs, some of the singers that came through the area, and the two distinct eras of bandstand. So in the mural from left to right, it starts out with Eddie Fisher, Fabian Forte, Bobby Rydell, Frankie Avalon, Jerry Blavitt in the middle, Al Martino, Chubby Checker, Charlie Gracie, James Darren, and then Danny Cedrone.
So when I was designing this mural, there's a couple key things I was thinking about. One is like the distinct design of the album covers of that era, I think really stuck out to me, like the really stark use of certain colors and how they appear in some of the albums. So I thought about that. I thought about old television sets.
If you look at some of the basic major shapes in the mural, it mirrors like a television set from the 50s, even sort of that stylistic upper angle that the wall shape takes. And all the musicians, for the most part, share equal space and sort of this ray effect from the center. We put Jerry Blavitt at the center because he's still out there, you know, with his radio show and as a DJ, sort of spinning the hits and presenting these musicians to the world.
I know Jerry since he's a kid. I knew Jerry when he was a dancer on Bob Horn's bandstand.
Jerry Blavitt, matter of fact, we went to the same high school together. We went to Bishop Newman High School, 26th and Moore.
And then finally got into the DJ thing. And he did very well for himself, God bless him.
He's an icon here in Philadelphia, he really is. I mean, you ask anybody walking down the street, who's Jerry Blavitt? And they'll say, Jerry Blavitt, you mean you did the geeter with the heater?
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock, we're going to rock around the clock tonight.
My name is Jerry Blavitt. They call me the geeter with the heater, the boss with the hot sauce. My favorite color is blue, 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 and I'm never blue. I'm always happy. I'm going to give you a book which you can read, and you'll find out how I came up with the name the geeter with the heater. It's in a book you only rock once. I was a kid 13 years of age, and I danced on a show called Bandstand. This was before Dick Clark had Bandstand. It was locally Bob Horn's Bandstand. And I was pretty spiffy as a dancer, and I would win dance contests. Dick Clark took over. Even though we picketed, Bob Horn was done. I stayed with Bob Horn. I went to Houston, Texas. I got a job as a record promoter. When I came back, there was a group called Danny and the Juniors who had a song called At the Hop. I became the road manager. And then when I came back to Philadelphia, I got into a crap game. Crap is shooting dice. And one of the guys that was shooting dice owned a club called the Venus Lounge. So I said to him, well, I'll tell you, I can do something. I can put a radio show in there. He said, how are you going to do a radio show? I said, I know how to do it. He said, you'll never get it done. I had the dice in my hand. I said, I got to make my number, my point. If I make my point, my number, without crapping out, you give me the money to do a show. One pass, two pass, third pass, I made my number. He said, okay, if you're that lucky, do me a show. So I went up and I started to play my rock and roll records. All the oldies that I used to dance when I was a teenager on Bandstand. And they heard this guy, Jerry Blavitt, finger popping, rhyming, doing everything, ooh, poop a doo, how do you do? Don't be ashamed, mention my name, don't holler, ain't gonna cost you a dollar. Phones lit up, and that's how it began. And back in the day, disc jockeys were not allowed to play the music that they wanted to play. A program director is the guy who said and programmed the music. I never went by a program director. When I got in the show business, I knew where I was going. I wasn't going to have anybody tell me how to entertain. I did it. I did it by looking at the audience, gauging the audience, finding out what they like, what they don't like. And when I went on radio, I continued with the geeter with the heater, the boss with the hot sauce. And I created 60 seconds, make 1 minute, 60 minutes, make 1 hour, 24 hours, make 1 day. And out of that 24 hours, 2.5 hours are dedicated to the young teenagers, to the hippest show on the radio.
Are you in this hassle with the crazy one here? All right.
Jerry Blanton.
What do you do, sir?
Geeter with the heater.
This man is probably the most prominent young people's disc jockey in the city of Philadelphia in Camden, New Jersey.
You know, I'm blessed. Again, you got to read the book, because I came from a broken family. My father, Jewish racketeer. My mother, a little Italian girl. Back then, in 36, you didn't marry out of your faith. I was born in 40. My father was in and out, number business, loan sharping, bootlegging. So we were raised by nuns at St. Monica's Day Nursery, because my mother had to get up early in the morning and go to the work at the Navy Yard. I followed my dream, my passion. Out of the loneliness of a little kid, skinny little kid, not being able to play on the streets during the summertime like the other kids, because we had to be in bed to be up at 6 a.m, I listened to radio. People say the Geeter's an icon. I don't consider myself an icon. I just consider myself lucky enough to follow my passion and my dream. And I am honored and humbled that people recognize perhaps what I've done. They may not know the struggle that I had to go through, the obstacles that I had to go through to continue doing what I'm doing. Because as I said, I play music from a heart, not a research chart. If I hear it and I like it, it hits me here, I want it to hit you there.
At the beginning of that year, we started conducting small interviews. I met with Jerry Blavitt in the studio, and we had a conversation about the direction and the theme of the mural. And, you know, Jerry's insight into the era was priceless, because it really gave me a place to start. And the great part about this mural is that it was a reimagining of the original South Philly Singers mural, which was right in front of Pat's and Gino's. So we had a place that we all started from, and we could discuss, you know, what everybody, where everybody wanted to go with this mural. We had a good idea of how everybody should be included, or who should be included, and then the trick was how to get everybody to share the space in an interesting way. Three of the performers I actually positioned together because they perform together, they go out and tour together. So it was Frankie Avalon, Fabian Forte, and Bobby Rydell.
Well, Bobby, most recently we've been hanging out together once in a while. He's a great kid. I knew his mother and father. They're from the same neighborhood, you understand? A few blocks away.
Rydell had a manager called Frankie Day, who was a musician with Billy Duke. And he said, I got a kid, I want you to hear a tape. I heard the tape, I gave it to a guy called Bernie Binnick. Bernie Binnick with Cameo Parkway. That's how Bobby Rydell started.
My name is Bobby Rydell, and I guess I'm part of the mural in South Philadelphia because I was born and raised in South Philadelphia, just like most of the artists who are on the mural. Fabian, Frankie Avalon, James Darren, Jerry Blavitt, so on and so forth. I think that's why I'm on the mural. I'm a South Philadelphia guy.
The way I got into the into show business is at a very early age. If I had any talent within me whatsoever, my dad was the first one to see it. Used to take me around to nightclubs in Philadelphia when I was like 7, 8 years old, and ask the club owner, is it okay if my son got up and sang a song and did a few impersonations? And, you know, actually, you know, being that young, you know, 7 years old, I'd get up and do my thing and people would applaud. you know, I say, oh my God, you know, all I have to do is do this and they do that. What a wonderful feeling. At that very early age, where my dad used to take me to all of these clubs, that became like my kind of vaudeville. And it kind of prepared me for what was going to happen to me, you know, later on in my career.
The one and only Bobby Rydell!
Coming on to my 60th year in the business, I had my first hit record. I was 17 years old, the summer of 1959, called Kissin' Time. I remember, you know, back then when I first started off, I think I weighed about 90 pounds, 92 pounds, soaking wet. And, you know, the fans of mine, you know, the teenagers, their mothers, their grandmothers, they used to say, my God, he's skinny. We have to feed this guy, you know, a teenage idol. That's the way all of us started out, you know, Frankie Avalon, Fabian, James Darren. At that particular time, you know, the teeny boppers, you know, with the poodle skirts and yada yada and so on and so forth. And we were considered teen idols, you know, back then. You know, it's just a process, you know, going from teenage idol to becoming an adult performer, becoming able to do nightclubs like the Copacabana in New York City. And then, of course, later on in our career, we started doing other things. I made motion pictures, everybody else made motion pictures. That's the way it should be. That's the The Golden Boys, that's the three of us, myself, Frankie Avalon, and Fabian.
We're going to hopping, we're going to hopping today. We make some popping, Philadelphia win. We're going to drop in, and all the music they play on the bandstand.
And my manager had an idea back at the time, this was back in 1985, to put three Italian kids who were teenage idols to go back on the road and do our thing. And I turned to Frankie Avalon, who I've known since I was 10 years old, you know, because Frankie played trumpet, I played drums, and, you know, all of that. And I turned to Frank, I said, this is really fantastic, Frank, but how long is this going to last? You know, we were on the road for like a year and a half, so I said, 2 years, tops, it's over, it's run its course. That was 1985, it's now 2018, we're still doing the show to tremendous crowds. And Frankie has a great line. He says, you know, here are the three of us. In South Philadelphia, we used to hang out on the street corner together, and now we're hanging out on stage together. You know, the fans over the years have been absolutely tremendous. And without them, you know, I wouldn't be, you know, here today. I hope I'll be doing this as long as I possibly can. I can't think of retiring because I don't know what the hell I would do.
I think the mural does bring a bit of nostalgia to the people who lived through it, because I would hear it every day while I was working on the projects. You know, I would have all these people who would come up to me who would seem like a lot younger than they actually were, and they would tell me stories about either performing with the musicians that worked with some of these guys. There was a few women who approached me that said they swore that they were in some of those bandstand photos. I didn't necessarily grow up with this music or grow up with these people per se. No, my family, my parents did, my grandparents. So I, the connection I felt was more about like the neighborhood. Philadelphia's a big place, and when we were installing it, a lot of people come up to us and say, "What about this person or that person?" Right? Like the, you know, Sound of Philly, Philly Soul, Kenny Gamble, you know, right up the street. And it's like, we could make a lot of murals about that, and we should, right? But this is a completely distinct era that we're talking about right here. And I think that's what's so great, you know, that there's the opportunity for all these murals to address these very particular parts of Philadelphia's history. I had a very colorful conversation with Charlie Gracie about growing up in South Philadelphia.
Charlie Gracie, one of the first artists to have a hit record on a new label called Cameo Parkway.
I've been in Charlie's company quite a few times. We do songs together. We have dinner together, him, his wife, my wife, and myself. He's just a super dynamite guy, and it's awfully great to be able to call him a friend.
My name is Charlie Gracie. I'm a musician, a vocalist, a performer. I've performed on radio, television, film, personal appearances, not only in the United States, but throughout the world. And I'm still doing it at my age, 29, at 82. And I'm very happy to be alive and still happy to be doing what I've done all my life to make people happy while they're seeing me perform. When they go home, their troubles are still there waiting for them, but them few hours that they spend with us, hopefully we bring them some joy. I was born on May 14th, the year 1936, right smack in the middle of the Depression. Things were kind of rough, but never went to bed hungry. I lived with my grandparents and my parents in a little row house in South Philadelphia. When I was 10 years old, my dad and I took a walk down to the place called South Street. To cut a long story short, let's take a walk. We took a walk about maybe 8 or 10 blocks from the house. And every time we'd pass a pawn shop, there were a lot of pawn shops in that street, haberdashers, shoe shops, you know. And once, finally he got in front of one pawn shop, he said, "You know what, Charlie, pick an instrument out, make something of yourself. I don't want you to work like a ducky like I have all my life in a factory." Well, 10 years old, what the heck, and I was shocked, you know. I said, "How about a nice trumpet like Harry James?" "Nah," he said, "you don't want a trumpet, get a guitar. What choice did I have?" So we bought the guitar. He said, "You know what, if you're going to be a musician, you get a teacher, you learn the right way." And I studied for 5 years. By the time I was 15 years old, I was fairly accomplished. I think it was a gift from God. You know, I'm a firm believer in destiny. I think it was my destiny to be a musician. And it came to me easily. I didn't have a hard time learning to play. I mean, what a great instrument to me. It's like my wife. You know, I've had that in my arms more than I had my wife in my arms. we used to work 7 nights a week when I was a young fella. 5 sets a night. My calluses had calluses. But you know what? If you love it, it's not work. And before you know it, I'm becoming a performer. My God, I was just a kid. So finally, I was on a television show called The Paul Whiteman Show. So now, while I'm on the show, this chap heard me singing and playing the guitar. And he had a record company called Cadillac Records right on Broadway. And we met, and sure enough, I went to New York, I cut my first record. And I began my recording career. And this went on from 52, 53, 54, 55, 56. No great success, but I'm building an audience, I'm building a fan base, and I'm working in the nightclub industry, because I've always been a nightclub performer. So in December of 1956, we went into the studio and cut 2 songs, one called Butterfly, one called Land That I Waste. By March, not only had a hit record, number one hit, my God, I thought my mother was going to say, "Get up, Charlie, it's time to go to school." It's like a dream come true, you know, I couldn't believe this. My whole life changed. My God, a number one hit, everybody wants you now. I played the Brooklyn Paramount Theater with the Alan Freed Show. I did the Ed Sullivan Show. I toured Europe, 57 to 58. Only the second American to bring rock and roll to the European continent. This happened like, wow, you know. I must have recorded 200 songs in my life. Everybody knows me for the same 4 or 5, because they were popular. I consider my life to be a great success, not because I'm a great talent or because I'm a great guy, but because I'm a survivor. 66 years went by, I still make a living singing and playing the guitar. Of course, along the way, I had some success with records and television shows, and I mean, I played to 5,000 people at a time, 10,000 people at a time. I was on the Ed Sullivan Show, you know, with, listen to this, with Don Ameche, Henry Fonda, and Will Chamberlain. Philadelphia's Will Chamberlain. And the guy said, "Hey, kid, if you got 5 minutes, you're on." I said, "Okay, what's the problem?" He said, "Tonight, 65 million people are going to see you." I'm going to pull the janky. I mean, he said, what a thrill. It's for a guy from South Philadelphia, you know what I mean?
You're flying, it's true, because I'm crazy about you. You butterfly.
I mean, in my career, I've met some of the greatest people. Just most recently, the last 10 years or so, I was asked to go on the road with Van Morrison to be his opening act. Gotta be kidding me. What a great talent. He wants me to open for him. Charlie's, I came to see you when I was a kid. Graham Nash recorded on my last 2 albums. And a guy said to me, "Charlie," said, "Paul McCartney wants to meet you." I said, "Get out of here. Paul McCartney wants to meet me." "Yeah," he said, "a big fan of yours." "Oh, okay." So I got backstage. He put his arms on to Charlie. He says, I love you, man. I've been a big fan of yours. He said, give me your book. Let's hold your book, you know. How gracious can you be? Wrote the foreword on it. I mean, you know, this guy's got 50 million things going on in his brain. And he's thinking of Charlie Gracie. It's astounding to me. Will you tell me your love? Say it'll be true. Will you fly around with somebody new? But I'm crazy about you. You butterfly. So, I mean, I've had it all. I've done it all. But I never achieved, like, let's put it like the Elvis Presley pinnacle or the Beatles pinnacle. But, you know, I was there before they all were there. Because when I went to Europe and performed there, in my audiences were the Beatles, Van Morrison, the Rolling Stones. When they came to see me, as the later years went on, they told me I was their inspiration. Whoever thought. Never claimed to be great or even good. All I'm saying is that I survived. I must be doing something right. Whatever it is, I'm going to keep doing it until they throw dirt in my face. That's about it. What can I tell you? You butterfly. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba-bum.
Yeah, I think it's pretty amazing to know that they're still performing in this day and age.
I really never even thought of, you know, stopping, you know, my career. I'm 76 years old right now. I'm singing better than I've ever sung in my life. Oh, wild one, I'm gonna tame you down, oh, wild one, I'll get you yet, you bet.
No, there's no difference from my day now to when I first started out when I was 13 as a dancer.
For people to still come out and see you after all these years is a miracle. I go to them, are you sick of listening to me? Nah, we love you, Charlie, you're better now than you were 50 years ago. I'm not gonna argue with him. I'm very humble and very proud to be part of the great Philadelphia music sound. I don't think there's a city anywhere in America or in the world that has produced more musical talent than Philadelphia, and especially South Philadelphia. You gotta remember, we're all from like a 10 block radius. It's amazing.
We were all kids together. We're all basically the same age. So we grew up together in that neighborhood.
They used to say, you know, why did so many people come out of South Philadelphia? Myself, Frankie, Fabian, Mario Lanza, Al Martino, Buddy Greco, Joey Bishop, Jimmy Darin, Chubby Checker. I don't know. I think it was a water trough on 9th and Dickinson. If you drank out of it, you became a singer. If you put your feet in it, you became a dancer. If you put your feet in it and you drank out of it, you became a song and dance man. Who the hell knows why all of us came out of South Philadelphia? But we all did, and we're all much prouder for it.
When you're a performer or an artist, there is a family that comes together. And even if you don't see each other for a period of time, you never forget each other. And you talk on the phone. And you'll see each other and you'll have some macaroni together.
It's almost like we're part of a cult. You know, all of us guys, we are part of a cult. And once again, I'm very proud to be part of that cult. And to see the mural on the wall, you know, it's something that, you know, brings back a lot of memories, you know, from not only people here in Philadelphia, but for wherever they come from.
So finally making it on the wall, what an achievement for a little kid from South Philly, you know what I mean?
I mean, that mural, you know, on Broad and Tasker is, you know, is a part of Philadelphia. There's no doubt about it.
That mural represents something for young people, not only in South Philadelphia, but in any part of this great country of ours, who finds a passion and wants to pursue a career. Do it. That's what that mural represents. These are people from the neighborhood who were very successful because they followed their dream, followed their passion.
Every night, a good time.
Well, let me say this. I want to thank you folks for coming out today, Graham and Gwen. You got to get a little recognition too. You know what I mean? You got a little piece of pie for everybody here. And I hope your project becomes successful. And I'm very happy to be a small part of it. If I talk too much, you can always edit it. You know what I mean? But you know, you say hello to me and I'll make a speech for 47 years ago. I should have been a lawyer. I had made a lot more money, I'll tell you that much.
Now, before you guys go, I want to thank you two. They're behind the scenes. These young kids have a passion and a love for what they want to do. And I got to say to them, you got to keep on rocking, because you really only rock once.
You love what you do, you guys, right? So you might be the next Cecil B. DeMille or Cecilia B. DeMille.
What do I encourage people? This is what I encourage people.
E-A-G-L-E-S, Eagles!
That's my motto.
And then there's a shalom aleichem, shalom aleichem, shalom, shalom, shalom aleichem. Then we go to the letter, the ding, ding, the tithe, and then the Polish thing. Like everybody, we're all mongrels for Christ's sake. You know, the only real Americans are the Indians, and they got a raw deal.
Oh my God.